the back of one of our ceremonial dresses. My grandfather and I hunted the deer that I had the hide tan, and then most of the shells and the bear grass and all the shells, clam shells, abalone shells, and bear grass I gathered myself. I gathered the bear grass from the burns, the fires that I had worked on. I worked for the Forest Service for 40 years. I'm retired, but I was a fireline archaeologist for the Six Rivers National Forest. So after the burn, I would go back the following spring and pick the bear grass. That's the white that you see right here. That's the bear grass that I got from the fires. And I picked the olivella shells up around Crescent City at Point St. George. Then I picked the olivella shells up at Fort Bragg. So all of these, and these are ocean rounded. The only ones I bought were these round discs. I found, after my grandfather passed away, I found these mother pearl shells in his bedroom. So I put those on my dress. And I picked these clam shells up at on the beach and down by Eureka. So the deer, my grandfather and I harvested on Frying Pan Ridge and over at Bear Lakes. So I know those deer up close and personal. I was raised by my grandparents, and when I was raised to gather, we were always out every other weekend or every weekend, but definitely a couple times a month, going out and fishing. Right now is the fall time. We've just finished our world renewal ceremonies. So the fish are coming up, the acorns are dropping. This is a big black oak acorn tree. I get nice acorns in my front yard. We like to use the tan oak acorns, but this is black oak. But usually the first to fall are the ones that have something wrong with them. So we usually wait, and also the first ones to fall, see how that's brown? It should be white, which indicates to me that there may be a bug in it or a pathogen. So the first ones to fall in the first rain, we give to the animals and let them take them, because the deer love the acorns and the bear. So our management in our ceremonies are an ecological management of our homeland. Our ceremonies signal the time that we go up and visit the rain rock and make medicine and pray for rain. It's a time that our world renewal ceremonies, one starts in Inam at the northernmost portion of the Klamath River Karuk territory. Then it goes down to Panomnik for 10 days. And that is one of the more southern. We go down to Bluff Creek, the Karuk tribe. And then it goes back to the middle, the center of our universe, which is Ishipishi Falls, Ketamine. And that's where I believe when you folks came, we were just ending up the ceremony at that time. And we know that it's gonna rain at that time. Our people have been on the river for thousands of years. We've actually, before the Karuk learned how to process the salmon, we were the ridge runners. Our sites up there are 3,000-4,000 years old along the ridge systems, the trails, the ceremonial areas. That's why they're so important to us. Within the last 1,000 years or so, the Karuk people came off of the high country, the high elevation. This is all climate related too, and came down to the riverine area and learned how to process those resources, the fish, the Yurok and Karuk, and Hoopa, they all work together, share a material culture. So the Yurok had a strong fishing technology. So did the Hoopa and the bow and arrow. And the Yurok had the boats. And they got together with the Karuk. So even though we're came three different times in history, we share the same material culture, but we speak three different languages. That's a lot of working together, a lot of teamwork. And so that when you come to Karuk country, we've never been moved. A lot of tribes have been moved. They tried to move the Karuk out of their country and then over to Hoopa Reservation, but that was not our country. And so a lot of people snuck over and came back into the Klamath River. Also, In the 1860s is when they found gold. We were rich in gold. And so the miners came in, systematically burnt our villages. And so we've had a harder time because we were in gold country. And we learned to adapt. A lot of the men were killed through time. A lot of diseases came by. And then the women were here, the backbone. And they intermarried with a lot of the miners. And a lot of the families still stay here. This is where we belong. I've gone over a lot of areas in the country with my job, archaeologist for the Forest Service. I'm also a forester and a firefighter. But I've always been lonesome for home because we know it so well. And that's why we cultural resource specialists can recognize things that other archaeologists can't, because I've been to archaeology school. I have a degree in archaeology. We don't get trained in recognizing the ground stone. You know, a lot of times it's projectile point styles, because we can do time. You know, we can look at the projectile points and kind of judge what time frame they were possibly made in. Now there's variables, you know, was it found by another person and taken to the site, the older projectile points. But anyway, this is part of my life. All the plants, I was raised gathering the plants. My grandparents taught me the basics of how to live. We have a steep country. We're fairly isolated. What we gather, we use to make our lives better, like food resources, medicines, herbs. And so fire is one of the ways that we manipulate the vegetation to provide the resources we need. My friend, she was a non-Indian. She came to work at the Six Rivers National Forest, and she spent time with us, and she began to learn how important fire was. So she did her master's thesis in archaeology and anthropology at Sacramento State. And what she did was looked at all the old Forest Service records, the ethnographic interviews with Karuk people, and the vegetation, you know, that had been like Skinner, Carl Skinner, and things, you know, that they had researched. So what she put together, this is just kind of trying to condense things. It is thought that around the villages, Happy Camp is a Karuk village, Orleans is a Karuk village, Somsbar is a Karuk village, that a 2-mile donut was burnt by the women to provide for a fine grain mosaic. That's oak woodlands, grasslands. You could still see the footprint, but the conifers crowding it out in the valley now. The women burnt for oak woodlands, grasslands, edible medicinal plants, basketry material, which I'll show you a little later in our tour. And basket material. Then after, so you're 2 miles out from the village, 2 miles out, fine grain mosaic. Then the men burnt for a coarse grain mosaic from that 2 mile donut, 2 more miles out. So you're 4 miles out. The men burnt for a coarse grain mosaic for animal food, the elk and the deer and the other animals that they utilized for hunting, and then for the clarity underneath the camp, you know, underneath. Because right now, if you go through a ride on our mountains, you can't see back up in there because it's so crowded with so many different layers of vegetation. So we're 4 miles out from the village. Beyond that was a management of lightning, and then the men burnt. So it was kind of, you know, not as regimented. And also our people stayed in one place. We had the village. We gathered from the bottom of the river up to the top of the mountains, and then a little sideways. Each village had their own family, their village, their personal gathering areas, and those were managed and manipulated with fire to provide the resources that we need. Because again, if you go out and you drive around, what you see right now is not the way it looked. If you look at 1932 photos, there's hardly any vegetation on the hill slopes. If you look at the trees, a lot of the old growth fire resistant trees were logged in the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s around here. So we have a lot of advanced reproduction of the conifers. And that's a lot of times for us, especially in Slater Fire last year, that's what carried our fire. That east wind pushed it. The electricity line broke, sparked. East wind was pushing it, and we had the fuels. So for us, manipulating the vegetation is a good tool. Also, for basket material, when you burn an area for basket material, let's say hazel, I have another friend, relative, when she went to get her master's degree in botany, she did it on burned and unburned bear grass and hazel. And because we always say it needs burnt, the people, Karuk, we call ourselves the people, Karuk means upriver people, Karuk, we say that it needs to be burnt, but a lot of the managers say, can't we just cut it? So what she did for her master's thesis in botany, she studied burned and unburned sticks of bear grass, or blades of bear grass and sticks of hazel. And she found that the sticks of hazel, after it came back, it had a thinner outer bark and the cellular structure inside was changed so that it could be twisted and torqued and made into baby baskets, which I'll show you a little later this morning. Bear grass, our bear grass is the only white. Okay, so back up. Hazel, we use for the strength. If we want strong baskets, like cooking baskets, things that were baby baskets that require the strength, we use the hazel. The bear grass is the white in Karuk baskets, and that's the only plant that we use for white. So it's kind of a high melon lily, and the blade has a mid rib vein if it's not burnt. If it's burnt, it'll come back and it'll be kind of less on a blade, kind of less outer material, outer cellular structure, and the structure inside the blade will change so that it can be twisted and woven with without breaking. So those are just an example of why, and again, back to the blade, when we weave, bear grass is an overlay. It's not a strength. Willow root, spruce root, that is our strength roots. So then the bear grass is just the overlay white color. And you'll see as I show you some of the baskets a little bit later.